And I walked out. When I got outside, it hit me.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the Supremes.
Folks went by and I congratulated them, but Diana just kept walking. To something different.
Everything for the artists. The songs were written at the Motown studios, produced and arranged there, and marketed on several labels. The company also taught the singers how to perform the patented dance steps, and even had a charm school that included lessons on how to walk, talk, and act in public.
I haven't spent that much time with them since they left the company, which was
Years ago.
Diana Ross.
Diana Ross is, she's classy. Diana Ross is, she would, when the lights come on, Diana Ross comes on. I mean, I don't care what the rehearsals were. We would rehearse a number and she would just be fair, rehearsals, so forth and so on. Or doing a movie, Lady Sings the Blues. I mean, we rehearse and I would, you know, say, put it into rehearsal. And she would say, I'm doing it, I'm trying it. But boy, when those lights came on, Diana Ross came to life. I mean, she's a money actress. For the money, she can do it, whatever it is.
You loved her.
I loved her, yes, and still do.
But you do you still love her the way you did?
I mean,
she's
no.
The mother of your child.
That's right, yes. No.
You had five wives, eight children?
I'm sorry?
Five wives, eight children.
No,
eight children by five different
yeah,
women.
Yes.
Not wives.
Yeah.
Yeah. But was she the love of your life? Diana.
I would say so. And looking back, yes, because she gave me more thrills than anyone.
What do you mean by thrills?
Well, thrills on the stage. I mean, you know, when a person can do, her thing was, when if you can think it, I can do it. And anything I could think
if
of.
If you can think it, I can do it.
Yes, and when I wanted her to do Lady Sings the Blues, play the life of Billie Holiday, she had never acted before. She had never done anything. But it was a thought I had, and I felt that she could do it. And she believed it. If I thought it, she could do it. And she did. And she was nominated for Academy Award. And the movie was nominated for five.
Why didn't you two stay together?
Well, when she got married, I asked
myself. A lot
myself,
of this book is about relationships.
That's right. The book is about a lot of things.
Right.
You know, it's not just music, singing, and dancing
right.
and so forth.
It's about life.
It's about relationship, about life. It's about love. It's about winning and losing and how to win, how to lose. Mm-hmm. You know, it's about values. But
Diana Ross, why didn't you stay together?
Well, Diana, I asked myself that same question when she got married. I said, well, wait a minute. The reason we did not stay together was because I knew what she wanted, and she wanted stardom in the worst way, and I wanted it for her. We had a goal. We had we had told each other that we would never let our relationship get involved with her career and my vision and my plan, and we were focused on that. But the relationship started getting in the way. It is very hard to, during the daytime, be this director and this person directing this talent and not letting them get away with anything. And every time I would maybe question her, she may think it's an attack or something. Yeah. But really, I'm trying to, you know, my standards were high. So it's one thing to direct a person and do a lot of things like that during the day, during the day, and then at night, try to be a cuddly bear.
Hard to keep them separate, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know, and so...
So you come into the bedroom, and she say, "You're no cuddly bear," because I remember 5 hours ago.
Yeah. And even if she didn't say that, even though she appreciated it, see, Diana was very interesting, and even though we would fight over certain things that I might say in terms of directorial remarks toward her or that it wasn't good enough, whenever she did a show, it did not matter who or anybody, what anyone said. It was like, "What do you think, Black?" You know. And if everyone says, "You're great, you're terrific, you're fantastic," if she wasn't really fantastic, I would have to say, "Okay, you were very good, but right here, you could do better," you know. And that wasn't always a good political thing to say, you know, to a top star that everyone says has
you're
done a
best.
Wonderful job.
Everybody says you're the best, and you're saying you can be better.
Yeah.
Roll tape.
It doesn't matter what career you are in. It almost doesn't matter how successful you are. That a lot of the problems are absolutely the same. One-to-one relationships with your husband or your wife or your lover or whatever. We all share a lot of the same problems. And they all can be cleared up just as well.
The past few years have brought enormous change to Ross's life. Her only marriage of 7 years ended in 1978 to Bob Silverstein, publicist and manager, father of their three children. They're still close, and they insist the color had nothing to do with their problem. Diana packed up the kids and moved from California to New York. Then this year, she broke with Motown Records, the people who'd guided and controlled her career for 20 years. So at 37, Ross started life all over again. You can hear it in her songs.
I've got to show the world all that I want to be, all my abilities. There's so much more to me. Somehow I'll have to make them just understand. I got it put in hand. Oh, how I plan.
She's made a clean sweep. Put a new manager on her payroll. For the first time, she produced a TV special. She signed with RCA Records at a reported $15 to $20 million.
Are we ready? Did you get the bass sound like you wanted?
And something totally new. She produced her own album, responsible for everything from music to money.
Did he give him 8 bars of the drum thing? I love that.
She says she trusts her own instincts now more than ever.
It's really important that you know about your business and your affairs, I think.
See, that's interesting, because I'm sure that most people who look at you on stage think that glamorous singer.
I hope so.
Not as a businesswoman.
It has to do with your survival. It's real important that you stop and take a look at what's going on, and either you can function in that or you better go somewhere where you can.
Ross dedicated her album to the people in her past who she says pushed her beyond mediocrity. She was warming up with Mirror, Mirror, a single she's just released. She's singing these days requires a mature, popular artist who can handle a musical range from ballads to 50s rock and roll to 80s funk.
There are a lot of songs in your repertory in your act that talk about independence. I'm coming out. It's my turn. It's my house. Songs that you sing that are just saying, I'm here, I'm me, you got to deal with the boss.
Kind of interesting that those songs came around at that time in my life when I was opening up or being more aware. It's like my awareness opened up. There's a world out there. I think I have a fairly good balance about my life. And I've had to go through lots of different stages. It has never always been about the stage, you know. I love it, and it's in proportion to where it should be. Like my father said, I have accomplished the things that I wanted to accomplish, and I feel like I want to give more.
Her feelings for her public are summed up in her biggest hit ever, Endless Love. People are wallowing in midlife crisis. Diana Ross seems full of youthful expectation. No one can deny this love I have inside. I'll give it all to you. My love, my love. My endless love.
Ladies and gentlemen, Smokey Robinson.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
If I started talking about my life with Motown, I think I'd take a real long time. But Motown is forever. And there's a strange thing, but Barry has always felt that he's never been really appreciated. It's a strange thing. I feel a little emotional, but it's not about the people who leave Motown that's important, but it's about the people who come back. And tonight, everybody came back.
Yeah! the name stuck, and they've been using it ever since.
The Supremes. Three teenagers. What were they like? What did you see?
They were cute, skinny, but they were trying so hard. They had their little dresses.
I've been trying.
I kind of liked the lead singer's voice. It was kind of whiny. And
lead singer was a kid named Diane.
Diane Ross, yeah.
Describe your relationship with Diana Ross. What was she to you?
Something like everything. You know, something like everything. I mean, Diana was, she was my baby.
Diana Ross became almost an obsession with Gordy. He even wrote a song for her in 1964 called Try It, Baby.
Now you're moving on up, pretty baby, leaving me behind. Everybody seems to love you. You're doing just fine, fine, fine.
Not only did he manage her singing career, she also starred in two movies he produced, Mahogany and The Lady Sings the Blues. The manager and the star fell deeply in love.
And he'll be big and strong.
You were in love with Diana Ross.
That's right.
Not
I
just
loved
love.
All my artists, but I was in love with Diana Ross.
Okay. Why didn't you marry Diana Ross? You loved her. She
yes.
loved you.
Yes.
Why didn't you get married?
Diana and I are the same kind of people. She wanted what I wanted. And we saw it up there. And we set out to get it. And we knew and we vowed that we would never let our personal relationship affect it like so many other personal relationships have affected performers and husbands managing them and this and that and so forth. But I'm working with her, and this is you know,
okay.
She's magic and she's mine, you know, and she's Diana Ross. And I loved her, but I wasn't selfish enough to want to marry her and take her out of what I knew she had to have. She had to have that stardom up there.
Not that Gordy was against marriage. He actually married three times and fathered eight children. Four were born out of wedlock, including one with Diana Ross. Mr. Gordy, you had a baby with Diana Ross, a little girl named Rhonda, who's now grown.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't tell Rhonda that she was your child until she was 13. Why?
We felt that it would be better for her sake that she did not know until that time.
Did you know at the time that Diana Ross was pregnant with your baby?
No, I didn't. We had broken up. And after that, we were together one night. She then married another man. And when she had the child, we had no idea that it was mine. And then as the child was growing up, you know, I'm looking and, you know, wait a minute. You know,
she looks like me.
Yeah, and so then Diana and I discussed it, and we realized that it was indeed my child. I was very close to the family, and Rhonda has called me Uncle Bebe all her life. We've had just a wonderful relationship since she's found out, and I love her very much.
Diana Ross finally left you in Motown.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Very painful?
Yes, very painful.
Have you forgiven her?
Yes.
You ought to tell your own story. But was there something about the Berry Gordy story that was wrong, that became part of the myth?
Oh, of course. I mean, that...
What was it that bothered you?
Well, no, it wasn't... Well, you know, it bothered me when people were not there and they wrote about things they had no idea about.
Yeah.
And because we moved so fast, no one could feel that a black kid from Detroit could do a Motown. That's the first thing. And so you'd have to be in a mafia, gangster, drug dealer, or whatever, you know, the people expected. So in my case, it was just that these people that came in were talented. It's all about people. Right. You know, Smokey was talented. Stevie was talented. Martha Vandellas was talented.
Diana was talented.
Diana was more than talented.
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
We know what you mean.
No, this is interesting because Diana plays a big role in the musical and a big role in your life. So much so, I was very surprised, Barry, that you wrote this, that you included on the play that the first time you were with Diana, that things did not go according to plan. You even said that you could not perform. I don't know any man. I don't know any man who would share that. Why did you decide you wanted to put that in?
Well, you know, I'm a normal person, and yeah. I've always wrote about normal people and myself. Yes. And I think that when you think of somebody as a goddess or somebody as the greatest thing, and you're getting ready to have sex with them, you know, something can happen always in your mind.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
So, you know, and that's what happened. You know, at the last minute, I said, what if? And then it was embarrassing from them.
But it's not embarrassing now. You and Diana have had a child together. Why did you two ultimately break up? I've always been curious about that.
Well, you have to come see the play.
Oh, really?
It's a play.
Okay.
No. It's there. It was a multitude of things. You know, things that happen in life. You know, mm-hmm. But love overcomes all.
Yes.
You know, and real love overcomes all. And Diana, I must say, was the key to so much that happened in Motown because she was my inspiration.
Yep.
And without her, I don't know that I could have done all the things that I did.
What was the hardest part? I mean, you had all this talent there. What was the hardest thing for you in building what you built?
The hardest single thing, I don't know. There was a lot of
little things. But
a lot of little things. I mean, it's you know, life is
life. So it was
life,
a piece of cake, you know, for you.
Well, you know, it was a passion. You know, when you, at 8 years old, I saw my family cry, my mother and father cry, and jump for joy when Joe Louis knocked out Max Schmeling for the heavyweight championship of the world. So and I got a passion at that time that I wanted to do something to make that many people happy. Yeah.
But it is all about the music, though. It brought black people together and white people together that even today, they say when you go into this theater, it's a very different kind of experience with the audience.
Oh, yes, it was music for all people. Yeah. It was music for all people.
And continues to be.
Yeah.